Bene, benissimo. So welcome to all. Today we have in this seminar to Jacopo Carusotto that is going to tell us about quantum fields in curved spacetimes. Please, when you want.
Okay. So Raul, thanks a lot for the invitation and thanks to all of you for being here with me online. So what I'm gonna tell you today is a sort of introduction on the concept of analog models and some recent developments that have been done in this field in Trento in the BC Center of the National Institute of Optics in collaboration with a few young people, very brave young people who are building their career on this field. Several of them have an origin, scientific origin from Trieste, namely Luca and Jamir. So I hope you will be pleased to see that they are progressing very well with their scientific career. So let me start from a very general introduction about what an analog model is. And to this purpose, let's consider this sort of Gedanken zoologic experiment. Basically, think of a river which on upstream flows very slowly, and then at some point it increases its speed until it goes into a waterfall. So suppose you are a fish and you are swimming in this region where the flow is very slow. So depending on whether your head points downstream or upstream, you will be able to swim in the downstream direction or in the upstream direction. In particular, we know that salmons are able to swim upstream for very long distances. So instead, if you are in this region where the speed of flow is faster than the maximum speed at which the fish can swim, nothing else can happen to the fish but being dragged by the river into the waterfall. Because whatever is the direction where the head of the fish points, the fish will be dragged by the current in the downstream direction compared to the reference frame of the surrounding land. So there is a point which we call horizon, after which the speed of flow is faster than the speed of swim. So there is no way that the fish can cross the horizon again. So once the fish have swam across the horizon, they cannot swim back upstream. So this point of no return is a sort of horizon as it happens in astrophysical black holes. So in black holes, whenever something crosses the horizon, there is no way it can come back in the external space. And its fate is to fall into the singularity of the black hole. So in this sense, this flowing river plays a very similar role to what happens to a black hole, to an astrophysical black hole. So this is a very classical picture. So our goal, the goal of the field of analog models, is to see how much this picture extends to a quantum world. So to move towards something more quantum, it's better not to focus on fish, but to something more abstract, which is some sound excitation. So here we have an object which flows from the left to the right with increasing speed. And if you have a loudspeaker in this fluid, you have a loudspeaker which emits waves on the subsonic side. Basically, the result is that these waves will be emitted by the source and will propagate as circular waves around the loudspeaker, but they will be able to propagate both in the downstream direction and in the upstream direction. And this is because the speed of sound is larger than the speed of flow of the fluid. On the supersonic side, instead, the speed of flow is larger than the speed of sound. So the sound will not be able to propagate back towards the horizon, and will be dragged in the downstream direction. So sound will not be able to travel back through the horizon and exit to the external region. So in a sense, this is more similar to what happens to light in an astrophysical black hole. So if you have a loudspeaker which is placed inside the horizon of a black hole and it emits waves, let's consider light to be more precise. So you have a lamp which is inside the horizon of a black hole, it will not shine light outside the black hole. Indeed, the black hole is black in this sense. Instead, if the lamp is placed outside the horizon, it will emit light and you will be able to see light coming out. Possibly distorted, but you will see light. So you see that this configuration is very similar to what happens in astrophysics around an astrophysical black hole. And given that we are dealing with waves, we can think that this picture could extend to some quantized radiation field, in particular to something which could support Hawking radiation. So this is the general idea of analog models, which has been put into mathematical in a mathematical language thanks to the effort of Bill Wu back in the 80s, and to have a very comprehensive review of this physics, I suggest to have a look at this review paper by Stefano Liberati and co-workers, where all the theoretical picture is developed. So just to, in a nutshell, for the specific case of atomic gases, atomic BECs, the general framework is to start from a Gross-Pitewski equation that many of you know, and write the Gross-Pitewski equation in the limit of low wave vector excitations, which have a phononic dispersion, to write this equation for a moving fluid in a form which closely resembles the equation for quantum fields in astrophysics. And after some manipulations that are very well summarized in this review paper, you can get to an equation which has the same form of a relativistic equation for a quantum field. So basically this is the operator, the box operator, in the metric G mu nu, which is a metric which depends on the properties of the flow. Namely, the speed of sound, the local speed of sound, and the speed of flow, and some prefactor. So basically, the idea is that you start from the equation of motion for the order parameter, GP-like, and with some manipulations, you can write an equation for the condensate phase in the form of a box equation in a suitable space-time metric. So this is the basic formalism of analog models. Starting from GPE, this is a classical equation. The crucial leap that was done by Bill Wu was to consider this equation as a quantum equation for a quantum field, which means to put a hat on top of the phi. So the phi is no longer a field, a classical field, but it's an operator. So upon this quantization, one can expect this quantum field theory on a curved space-time to give rise to some Hawking emission phenomenon. So the original proposal by Bill Wu was that this reformulation will give rise to some Hawking emission of sound waves from an acoustic black hole. This was the 80s, but at the time, there was the crucial point that there was very difficult to have systems with a suitably low temperature such that these physics can be observed. To be concrete, let us consider the simplest black hole geometry, which basically is a speed of flow which increases along the plus x direction, which shows an horizon at some position, and one looks for Hawking emission from this horizon point. We know that for astrophysical black holes, the Hawking temperature is an extremely low temperature. It's something which is of the order of a microkelvin for solar mass black holes, even lower for supermassive black holes that exist in galaxies. And this temperature has to be compared to the intrinsic temperature of our space, our surrounding space, which is basically dominated by the cosmic microwave background, which is of the order of a few Kelvin. So detecting a Hawking temperature of microkelvin on top of a cosmic microwave background of the order of a few Kelvin, it's something which is extremely difficult to do and almost impossible. On the other hand, for analog models, one has the formula for the Hawking emission, the temperature of Hawking emission of sound, which has this form, which depends on the parameters of the flow. And plugging in the numbers for actual atomic clouds, one finds something which is of the order of nanokelvin. You may think that nanokelvin is completely unachievable, but actually this is not really the case, since the laser and magnetic cooling techniques allow to obtain temperatures of ABC which are indeed of the order of nanokelvin, exactly the same range where one expects to have the Hawking temperature. Basically, this consideration, which was done in the early 2000s by several authors, basically gave the boost to the field of analog models based on atomic condensates, because it showed that for the first time, this physics is something that could be observed in the lab. But on top of this observation, there was another crucial result that was pointed out by Roberto Balbinot and Sandro Fabbri, and it was that the Hawking radiation in reality consists of pairs of correlated particles. Of course, this is a statement which has not by much interest in astrophysics, because it would be hard to detect some entanglement between particles which live on the opposite sides of an horizon, of a black hole horizon. So to detect the correlation between something which is inside the horizon of a black hole and something which is outside the black hole, it's just a speculation. It has no physical meaning, because the internal part of the black hole is something which is not accessible to experiment. If you want to do an experiment inside the black hole, basically you have no way to communicate the result with the external world. So it will be not a very practical thing to do. On the other hand, doing this kind of experiment in analogs is something which is completely possible. And in particular, working with the correlations between the Hawking particle and the partner give rise to a very neat signal of Hawking radiation, which allows to distinguish Hawking radiation from other phenomena, emission phenomena, which have no special interest, like some non-zero temperature of our sample. So to see it in the analogy of the river, one would have a sort of magic stick which via quantum effects, this H-bar, emits a pair of fish from the horizon, and these fish propagate on either side of the horizon in a correlated way, so that these two fisher women would catch fish in a very correlated way. So whenever the lady number one catches a fish, there is an increased probability that also lady number two will catch a fish at her position. So the correlation between the Hawking and partner particle would reflect in the probability, joint probability of catching fish on either side of the river. Of course, this is a joke, but can be put in practice in some physically observable quantity. This is the result of some old Monte Carlo that we did together with Roberto, Sandro, and Serena and Alessio. Basically, it's a Wigner Monte Carlo simulation of the quantum fluctuations in an atomic condensate. And among many different features that appear in the G2, which is the correlation between density at position x and position x prime, you see this tongue, which is highlighted by the purple circle, which is a sort of mustache-like feature, which says it's a correlation between a point which is outside the horizon, x smaller than zero, and a point inside the region, which is x prime larger than zero. So we are correlating points which lie on either side of the horizon. And this correlation, which is small but accessible, has some specific geometrical properties that can be predicted by theory, and it was done in this paper by Roberto and Sandro, and it was confirmed in our numerical simulations in this graph. So this numerical color plot is compared to the analytical position of the tongue, and we're finding a very good agreement. So this is a feature which depends on the correlation between either side of the horizon, and it's something which is very, very peculiar of Hawking gradation. And it was indeed used in the lab by Jeff Steinauer at Technion in Haifa to give the first hint of analog Hawking gradation in the lab. So this in this plot is the first experimental image of Hawking gradation taken exactly following our proposal here. And this feature that's here marked as feature number 3 seems to be related to this sort of seagull shape, which is present in the experimental graph. Of course, experimental life is much harder than our theoretical life, so the signal is much weaker. But if you look at this graph, which is an experiment, is a cut of the experimental line along an orthogonal line to the mustache, you clearly see the dip, which corresponds very well to our theoretical prediction in here. So this seems to be...
Jacopo.
Please.
What Steinauer has done in practice, what was the...
So what Jeff actually did was to take a condensate. It's a 1D elongated condensate, and to throw it against an optical potential created by a laser beam, which creates a sort of step-like potential.
So this was the critical horizon.
Exactly. Right. So the horizon was formed by a condensate which was sent on a light potential which was accelerating the condensate, so that a transonic point separating to a supersonic flow appears at the position of this laser beam. Then what Jeff did was to take an image of the condensate and to measure the local density at the different points in 1D. So this creates a single shot of the density. And then Jeff was averaging this picture over thousands of realizations. And from these thousands of realizations, he was able to correlate the noise in these images and to take an image of the correlations between point X and point X prime. And this black signature is visible in this noise correlation image.
Okay, thank
you. This was a kind of experimental tour de force. And it was even more remarkable since the first round of experiment was done by him alone. Then in the second version, from which actually this image is taken, he had some co-workers, including Juan Ramon Munoz de Nova, who's the first author of this second Nature paper.
Okay, thank you.
Good. So this was the first evidence of Hawking gradation. Then a second experimental result that Jeff claimed in the Nature Physics paper of 16 is some experimental evidence of entanglement between the two sides of the horizon, which would be the smoking gun of the quantum nature of Hawking gradation. Here, what he did was to measure some correlators between the bosonic operators on the two sides of the horizon, and he was measuring some excess anomalous correlation versus population according to this Peres-Rodeschi criterion. So having green larger than red and delta smaller than zero is a signature of entanglement. So his experimental data are here with the error bars. So you see that the error bars seem to confirm the quantum nature of his observations. This experiment is extremely difficult because you have to average and to obtain quantities which are very sensitive to the way you treat the data. So there's been in the literature a wild debate about the significance of this data. I'm not the person who is able to make a firm claim about the statistical value of this data. What I'm doing here is just to quote the results of Jeff and to pinpoint the paper where this is discussed.
Jacopo?
Yes.
I have a question about this interpretation. I mean, somehow, if I understood correctly this Peres-Rodeschi criterion, this implies that the initial state of your evolution has to be in thermal equilibrium. Otherwise, there could be some residual entanglement due to the fact that the initial state was not at equilibrium.
Yes.
Is there a way of cleaning up this assumption?
It is that for what I did personally, I was not able. But to have entanglement, which is really dangerous, seems to be a kind of strange thing. In a sense, mathematically, it's hard to believe that that entanglement is. In a sense, mathematically, you cannot exclude it, but it's hard to think of a mechanism which includes entanglement exactly in the way that would disturb you.
Okay.
But, you know, it's an uncontrolled assumption, which in a sense is not been validated yet. There could be some mechanism that people have not thought yet, which could explain this data. Okay. So in a sense, I would not put my hand on fire for this experiment for many reasons, but I think it's a beautiful enough experiment, which is worth studying in full detail and to really look at what's going on there. It's extremely intriguing. What I find personally very intriguing is marked here in this yellow box, is that for the first time we are doing quantum hydrodynamics. In the sense we are putting a hat on top of the Navier-Stokes equation. So we are doing a quantum Navier-Stokes equation. Okay, it's a bit pushed statement mine, but it's the direction where I find that these experiments are most intriguing. So we start building.
Can I ask a question? Sorry.
One second. Just one second, please. Mm-hmm. I finish the sentence. So we are dealing with entangled states of a macroscopic system. And I find this development extremely intriguing. So even if this experiment has a statistical problem, I don't care. They're wonderful because they stimulate investigations in this direction. So please, the person who was asking question.
Yes, it's me. So just to understand better the theoretical model. So in the model, so you have like an inhomogeneous speed of sound.
Yes.
Inhomogeneous, how inhomogeneous?
Basically, the speed of sound that Jeff has is more or less of this kind. V over C increases along the plus X direction. And there is a point where V equals C. So for X larger than XH, it's a supersonic. For X smaller than XH, it's a subsonic.
Okay. And I mean, and theoretically, you usually model these things really with the inhomogeneous thing or with a step function?
In a sense, in my original simulations here, it was a step function. Mm-hmm. In more refined numerical calculations that we are at the moment completing, we have a precise shape of the flow, which is the one of the experiment.
Okay, thank you.
But there is one more tricky point that is worth mentioning, is that the time dependence is crucial. So here in my old simulation, I took a very model time dependence of the system. So the black hole was created in a very mathematical way, which is physically meaningful, but not experimentally achievable. The new simulations are trying to use the experimental configuration that is used in reality to generate the horizon.
Which means that also the sound velocity also depend, it's a function also of time?
Exactly. That's the point. Okay. And this introduces some features which could be very disturbing, which could go in the direction of, I think it was Marcello's question about the way that uncorrelated initial fluctuations. Because having a time-dependent speed of sound could introduce some unwanted entanglement between modes, which is very dangerous.
Why you say unwanted?
Sorry, basically because you change the speed of sound and you are doing a sort of quench in the system. Mm-hmm. So in the language of non-equilibrium statistical mechanics. Mm-hmm. And basically this quench results in the emission of correlated particles in opposite directions.
Okay. It's like having a non-relativistic dispersion relation, essentially.
Exactly. So basically you are emitting the pairs in opposite directions, and these waves create some entanglement, and you have to get rid of this entanglement. Otherwise, this entanglement may seed the Hawking radiation, transfer to Hawking radiation, and make a mess. Mm-hmm. So this is the tricky point about this assumption. That's why I'm not putting hand on fire.
Thanks.
But it's raising a lot of interesting questions. So this quantum hydrodynamics is one of the most interesting directions where this field will be moving in the next years. Good. So let's move on to the new results. So all I presented is something which was theoretically known until the 2015. And the new things were experimental. Now let me move to some new theoretical development that we did in Trento, starting from what Luca Giacomelli has done. Luca did his master in Trieste together with Stefano Liberati, so it's somebody that you should, that many of you should know. So basically his PhD thesis is on super radiance. And the idea is to try to understand the super radiance from my quantum optician point of view and to see how analog models can give further insight on these fundamental gravitational processes. So the new geometries that we are considering are very similar, at least one of the prototype of these geometries is the two-dimensional vortex, which is in spiral. So there is a combination of acoustic horizon, which is the point where the velocity, the infalling velocity is equal to the speed of sound. And there is the ergo surface, which is the point where the total velocity equals the speed of sound. So basically, the acoustic horizon is the point of no return, as it was in a normal non-rotating black hole. The ergo surface is the point after which there exist modes with negative energy. So these are two different concepts which play a role in the physics we're looking. In particular, super radiance is an amplified reflection by transmission of a negative energy mode, and basically comes from the fact that I'm incident on the black hole with some positive energy wave. This energy gets reflected with a higher intensity, and the missing energy is provided by some negative energy mode, which gets excited inside the ergo surface, which drags away the negative energy which is needed to amplify the incident radiation. So this is the sketchy picture of super radiance, and basically reproduces many of the basic results, both theoretical and experimental with surface waves on these physics. But what we did with Luca was to try to understand the super radiance from a more basic point of view, trying to distillate what of this physics is due to the cylindrical geometry and what is due more to kinematic properties of modes. In particular, we focused on geometries which have translational invariance along the horizontal coordinate, where along the vertical direction there is an arbitrary dependence of the velocity. But we also assume that the irrotationally constrained, typically of black holes, of atomic BC is broken by using a synthetic gauge field. So how comes this? So you know from superfluid hydrodynamics that normally the velocity is proportional to the gradient of the superfluid phase. This, by definition, has a zero curl, so is a irrotational velocity field, which restricts a lot the kind of flow patterns that one has available for analog models. But in quantum fluids of atoms, or also in other kind of quantum fluids, but one has the possibility of engineering a synthetic gauge field. In the presence of a gauge field, one has the different relation between the superfluid phase and the actual speed, because the actual speed is due to the mechanical momentum. And the mechanical momentum by the minimal coupling is not only the canonical momentum, but also contains the vector field. So the actual flow speed of the quantum fluid is equal to the gradient of the phase minus the vector potential. So in this way, provided one engineers the A field in a suitable way, one can build profiles with an arbitrary Y dependence of the actual physical speed. And one removes the rotationality constraint. So this is very interesting because it widens the amount of analog models that one can build. So in particular, we considered the geometry, which is a translational invariant along X, not with arbitrary dependence along Y, and we exploit the translational invariance along X to use Kx as a quantum number, and we reduce the full two-dimensional problem in this metric, where Vx and C depend on Y, on the Klein-Gordon equation of this form, which very much resembles the Klein-Gordon equation for a charged field in an electrostatic potential, where the mass is related to the wave vector Kx of the excitation along X, and the vector, the zeroth component of a vector potential, say the scalar potential, is related also to the speed of flow along X, which then is a Y dependent quantity. So with this way, one can study the bosonic Klein paradox, which is basically what happens when one has charged particles hitting a jump in the scalar potential. In particular, if the jump in the scalar potential is large enough compared to the kinetic energy of the incident particles, one can have a configuration where one has the reflection of positive norm particle into negative, no, so the transmission of positive norm particle as a negative norm particle, which basically a positive charge particle which transforms into a negative charge particle. And in order to conserve charge, one needs to put an extra charge in the reflected wave. This is the bosonic Klein paradox, which is the sort of transmission of modulated transmission, is closely related to super waves. So in order to study this physics, we went back to the typical workhorse of GPEs, of condensates. So we did the full two-dimensional GPE independent of vector potential and scalar potential, exactly as needed. And we simulated a configuration where the incident wave is a positive norm mode, which can be transmitted as a negative norm mode, which is exactly what happens here. We have an incident norm mode, which can be transmitted as a negative norm mode there. So to do this physics, we did the VGP, and you see that we have an incident wave, which hits the discontinuity in the vector potential, gets transmitted as a negative norm mode, and the wave vector of these fringes exactly matches the wave vector of the transmitted mode. And one has a reflected wave with an increased amplitude. You see here, in green is the amplitude of the incident wave, which goes to zero when it hits the surface, the ergo surface. And the reflected wave, which is plotted in red, has a higher amplitude compared to the incident wave. And here, the amplification is as large as 70%. It's really a really sizable amplification. So in this way, we used very simple two-dimensional GPE simulations to study superradiance from a very simple configuration of an atomic gas, which shows a discontinuity in the vector potential of a synthetic gauge field. So the advantage of this configuration is not only that it's amenable to GPEs, but also that one can build a scattering matrix theory, which links the ingoing and outgoing Bogoliubov mode with positive and negative norm, so one is able to build a quantum optical picture of the superradiant phenomenon. And this is work in progress. So what happens if one considers a more complicated configurations? For instance, if one has a second interface, so one has a region of flow, so a region where the vector potential is non-zero only in a finite amount of space. Basically, what happens is that the wave packet hits the horizon, generates a wave in between the two ergo surfaces. This wave goes back and forth, oscillating between the two, and as time goes on, gets amplified by these continuous reflections. And this amplification, which is due to superradiance, turns the superradiant effect into a dynamical instability. So the dynamical instability is signaled by the fact that the wave, the amplitude of the wave in between the two interfaces grows exponentially with time, until, of course, nonlinear effects sets in. So this shows the dynamical instability due to superradiant effect. So this is something which is related to lasing and black hole lasing. So what transforms our superradiant scattering into an instability? Basically, the key ingredient for going from one regime to another is the fact that the light, which is generated by the superradiant scattering, remains available in the system for further superradiant scattering effects. So one continues to stimulate further superradiant scattering just because the wave which is created by superradiance does not leave the system. So this is a very general feature. We will come back to it in a second. So this is the...
Can I ask a question?
Of course.
What is this? So this is the bosonic super radiance, right?
Yes.
So what is the... I mean, imagine instead of the Klein-Gordon equation, you have Dirac equation. So there should be a fermionic analog of the super radiance. What would be that fermionic analog?
Yeah, actually for fermions, that's a kind of tricky question on which I have only a partial answer, because with Luca we were studying these before all the lockdown issues. But the main difference in the two cases is marked here. You can see here. So basically you have a conservation of norm. And the norm, which is relevant for the bosonic problem, is a norm with a non-defined metric. So you see here, the initial amplitude at a short time is one because you have an incident wave. So at late times, you have to sum the norm of the different modes, reminding that we are transmitting negative norm modes in the internal region. So you see that the norm of the red, which is 1.7, minus 0.7, which is the norm of the blue, give 1, which was the initial norm. So in bosonic systems, you have the U square minus V square equal 1. For fermionic, you have a plus. So there is no way of having something which exponentially explodes. Mm-hmm. Because the U square plus V square equal 1.
All right, thank you.
That's why this instability don't play a role in fermionic systems in the normal cases. Mm-hmm. But hopefully in a few months, I can give you a more detailed answer if there are cases where one can go around this kind of physics. For the moment, I've not found anything relevant.
All right, thank you.
Good, thanks. Good, so you see there is a super radiance scattering and there is a super radiance instability. So there are two different phenomena. So this is all the work that Luca did to understand microscopically what is the meaning of super radiant instability. Now, let's try to apply these concepts to something which is concrete. Say, the quantized vortices in a quantum fluid. So, you know from astrophysics that there exist two basic concepts of instabilities in black holes. One is the black hole bomb, which is basically when Hawking radiation emitted by a black hole is reflected at large distances and stimulates the emission of further Hawking radiation. So this is a phenomenon which has been predicted to arise for light massive particles. It goes under the name of Damour-Deruelle-Ruffini instability. And somebody has even claimed that it may have a role in the dark matter content of the universe. So I'm not a good person to discuss this physics, but I find very intriguing this possible link. Anyway, this is a phenomenon which occurs because of large distance reflection at large distance from a black hole. So there is another phenomenon, which is the ego region instability. And this basically comes when you have a stellar object which is compact enough to have an ego region. So it's a rotating star, so it has no horizon, but it's rotating fast enough to have an ego region. And in this case, the wave which stays in the business is the one inside the ego region. So there is a scattering at the ego surface. The waves which are emitted inside the ego surface stay there because there is no horizon to absorb them, so they can provide the self-amplification of the super radiant emission and give rise to some instability. So these are the two main classes of instabilities in astrophysics. So are they present in condensed matter systems? So if one looks at the vortex in a condensate, one has a complex combination of two effects. Because on one hand, the quantized vortex give an ergo region around the vortex core, because the vortex in a condensate flows in a supersonic way. But at the same time, there is a trap at large distance, which basically traps the condensate. So any standard system is in a trap potential. So what is the real physics which plays a role in an atomic condensate? Is it an ergo region instability, or is it a black hole bomb instability? So this was our big question with Luca. And we went back to the literature and we found several things. We found that, of course, multiply charged vortices are always energetically unstable. A singly charged vortex in an harmonic trap is energetically unstable but dynamically stable. Multiply charged vortices in traps are dynamically unstable, with a very complicated dependence on stability instability on the number of atoms in the condensate. So, in order to understand this physics, what we tried to do with Luca was to understand what happens in systems which are in spatially infinite geometries. So to disentangle the physics of the black hole from the physics of the trap. So to disentangle the ergo region instability from the black hole-like instability from the trap. So we took as a first step a large but finite system of size tending to infinity, and we find that for large enough radii, the system tends to a constant instability rate, and the instability is present for any value of the radius. So the instability domain separated by stability domain that were observed for trap systems in small sizes are an effect of the trap. But the intrinsic physics of the black hole, of the vortex, sorry, is to have an ergo region like instability. To check this statement, we also did the simulation without a trap, imposing absorbing boundary conditions at large R, which is a way to directly simulate a fluid with no trap. So what we did was to send a very small ingoing wave to trigger possible instability and to see how the system evolves. And what we found was that the system evolves very fast with a strong instability rate, whose value quantitatively matches the one found before for a finite but large system. So the vortex of multiple charge turns out to be unstable even in an infinite geometry, which means that the instability is of ergo region kind. Black hole bomb-like effects play no role in here. And in particular, the only possible effect of large distance physics is to quench the instability. So the black hole bomb effect is not there. It has rather a stabilization effect on the system. So we have confirmed the same physics in other configurations, and we have found some microscopic model of these physics, just by noticing that inside the ergo surface of the rotating black hole, there is a negative energy mode, which can be coupled to positive energy modes which are emitted outside, by parametric scattering processes, and the coupling of these two branches of modes creates some dynamical instability. As it is well known in dynamical systems, whenever you are mixing modes with different Krein norms in the language of Arnold's classical mechanics book. So if you want to have fun to understand this physics in real good and deep detail, just go to my homepage, look for the quantum optics course, and in there is an exercise which is to study the dynamics of a charged harmonic oscillator with negative mass and negative spring constant. This is a physics which exactly matches the physics of superradiant instability for a rotating vortex. So you can have fun solving the exercise, as my student had fun in doing in last semester. Good. So this is a very general physics. It holds for any vortex, no matter the charge. So it's a mechanism which really dominates the physics of vortices in condensed matter. So just to go back to a very basic problem, we have, many of us have learned from textbooks that singly charged vortices are energetically unstable, but dynamically stable. So this is a kind of misleading statement, because this is true only in a harmonic trap or in other special forms of potential. If you consider a potential, which is a sort of very wide harmonic trap with a small dimple in the center, and you create a singly charged vortex in this geometry, Luca realized that this configuration can be dynamically unstable under the spiraling of the vortex out of the center. So you create a vortex in the center, and this guy will start spiraling out from the center within a growing radius while emitting sound waves outside in the very large condensate. The fact that it does not exist, this effect does not exist in a harmonic condensate, is a sort of coincidence due to the spatially harmonic trap shape, which is used in normal traps. If instead of having harmonic trap, you have something which at long distances is much flatter, you get possibility of having instabilities even for singly charged vortices. Good. So this is the results which have already been kind of strongly established. Now let me spend the last 10 minutes on two new directions that are being explored in my group in collaboration with different friends, starting from one issue which was not yet well studied in quantum in the analog model, and it's what happens if you add some two-level emitter in a curve space-time quantum field theory. For instance, questions could be, how is Casimir effect modified if the two atoms are no longer in a flat space-time, but are in a curved space-time? Does it introduce any change to the Casimir force between two objects? Does the presence of a neighboring black hole modify the Casimir force between two objects? All these kind of questions, which are extremely exciting from the theoretical point of view, and for the moment remain a completely speculative questions, because I think it's very hard to go to next to Sagittarius Alpha and to make a measurement of Casimir effect next to a supermassive black hole. Here, analog models could be the way to experimentally investigate these interesting physics of quantum field theories. So to do this, together with Jamir and Alessio, of course, we found a way, an atomic physics way, which is able to obtain a two-level atom which is coupled to a Bogoliubov field exactly in the same way as a two-level emitter is coupled to electromagnetic field via the coupling, which is the dipole times electric field. So we want a coupling which has no charge, because an atom has no charge, but still its polarization can couple to electromagnetic field. So here we have an atom who is not, has no charge, so it does not normally interact to the Bogoliubov field, but it has a sigma x operator which drives transition from the ground to the excited state, and this transition couples to the fluctuations of density in the Bogoliubov field. So what could be the observable for this physics? Well, the simplest fact is that the atom can be prepared in the ground state and can be moved through the condenser at supersonic speed. We know that a neutral object does not emit light, but a supersonically moving atom can emit light by being excited at the excited state and at the same time emitting a photon.
Jacopo.
Yes.
I have a question on this because I'm not sure I understand. If you have a finite detuning over the transition that you are driving, does this correspond to somehow decay of excitations in this picture? Because it implies that ground and excited are not symmetric anymore.
So you mean in this plot?
Yes, that's correct.
So exactly. So what one is, we are addressing a transition between G to E,
yes,
with some resonant light.
Yes. No, but your light is not resonant.
Sorry?
Your light is not resonant.
My light is resonant with a G to E transition. And we have addressed the states, which are a superposition of E and G. But the scattering length of the two states is the same with opposite sign to the fluid. So the dress states, which are a mixture of E and G, have no net interaction with the outside fluid. Okay?
It's okay what you said.
Then the dressing between...
But this is not easy. I mean, you
No, it's not easy at all.
Okay. Because you need to have... I mean, there are not many species that with a third species, they have opposite.
But, you know, the third species can be another atom.
Yeah, sure. It can be whatever, yeah?
But you have a species which need to have opposite scattering length with something.
Do you have some species in mind? Do you know if there is an atom that does this, actually?
I don't, but I think we discussed with Carlos Sias, and we found that there are some possibilities playing with Feshbach resonances.
Okay.
Basically, you play with the fact that two states can have Feshbach resonance in a slightly different position. So
yes,
the ENG.
You're asking something extra, that they have something different and there is a point where they are exactly opposite.
Exactly, but you have an external parameter where you play and you tune the two and you look at the point where the two opposite were opposite.
Okay.
So it does not seem to be a completely crazy request. It's difficult, but one has to really to work out the tables. And one possibility could be to use ions rather than atoms as an impurity. Because then you have an easier way to move them.
Okay.
But that's the kind of technical detail. But then to go back to this picture, you have an optical field which creates dead states, and the two dead states are detuned by the Rabi. So the transition that we use is a transition between the minus and the plus with the detuning, which is the Rabi, and the dipole moment of the transition is due to the fact that the two G and E independently have interaction with the atomic cloud.
I think it is.
Good. So in this way, you can create an atom in the ground state. It moves supersonically through the condensate and creates excitations by some quantum effect where it is excited and simultaneously emits a photon. This is an effect which is known in quantum field theory. Whenever you have an emitter which moves at a superluminal speed in a quantum field. The problem is that any reasonable quantum field has a speed of is a phase speed which is relativistic. So it's very difficult to have a two-level atom which moves fast enough. Here you can have an impurity which moves supersonically through a BC, which seems to be a reasonable thing to do. If instead of moving linearly, you do it in circular motion, you can have more peculiar superradiance effects that can even give rise to some instability phenomena. And this was studied in the last work together with Jamir. I have no time to discuss it in detail. Have a look at the reference and let us know if you have some questions. Just a few minutes on the last dream, which is to investigate black hole evaporation in these analog models. So the conceptual framework is the fact that there is a big question of what happens when you throw things in a black hole. So think you are throwing your mother-in-law in a black hole. And the question is, how safe are you from she coming out of it as angry as ever, because information was not lost. So you throw her in the black hole, and once the black hole has evaporated, you find her again. Perhaps you have time to run away, but it's not clear if she's lost forever. So to put it more formal way, the entanglement between the external world and the inside of the black hole, is it completely scrambled by the black hole nature of the black hole and information is lost or not? There is a remnant of what has fallen into the black hole. So this apparently simple question is raising a lot of debate in the astrophysical community. I have no way to answer, but I was very intrigued. And I started thinking about what happens to an analog model after that Hawking radiation makes it evaporate. So instead of attacking the complicated initial case, I work in the simpler configuration of a dynamical Casimir emission, where I shake a cavity, I let light be emitted in the cavity by dynamical Casimir motion by dynamical Casimir from the moving mirror, and look at the friction that the wall feels by the Casimir emission. So the effect was calculated long ago, but it's ridiculously small. So one has to find some analog models. So our first proposal done together with Simone Dario and Cristiano is an all-optical model of a three atom in a cavity, where the dynamical Casimir emission has a very clear signature in the optical absorption of the atom, but it's a kind of complicated configuration. So simultaneously to the group of our friend in Messina, we consider the simpler case of a cavity formed by two mirrors, and one of the two mirrors is attached to a spring. And we look at the mechanical damping seen by one of these mirrors. So this is something which can be done in circuit QED, blah, blah, blah. One can study the free evolution of the mechanical oscillator, indeed shows some mechanical friction. And there is also some signature in the response to a monochromatic drive. But the most interesting thing is that this physics has very important quantum fluctuation effects. So the fact that the motion of the mirror is damped in time has some consequences at the level of quantum fluctuations of its position. In particular, depending on the resonant on of slightly non-resonant nature of the dynamical Casimir emission, the Wigner function for the mechanic motion can have very different shapes. So to study this physics, what we are presently trying to do is to set up a circuit QD phenomenon where the motion of the mirror is simulated by some LC circuit, which is concatenated to the squid, this which terminates a coplanar waveguides, so that just by looking at this quantum state of this extra degree of freedom, one can quantum simulate the mechanical motion of the mirror. So this LC circuit plays the role of the mirror, and this coplanar waveguide plays the role of the Casimir cavity. This is not completely crazy, because there have been experiments by some group in Sweden very recently. Good, so it's time for me to conclude. So basically, I try to convince you that these cold atomic gases, as well as other systems, are very flexible analog models to explore gravitational phenomena. So there are many systems with many phenomena which can be investigated, like Hawking radiation, super radiance, but also more fancy physics, which is related to emitters coupled to curved space-time quantum field theories, or back reaction effect due to the back reaction of, say, the Hawking emission on the black hole horizon. These last points are present subject of intense investigation. We hope there will be some experiments coming out in the next future. So my feeling is that this is a field which is in a phase of very strong explosion. So stay tuned. And with this, I thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Jacopo. Very nice talk. Some question?
Yes, so I have a question. So about this last point, the back reaction effects that you were mentioning. So again, to come back to the model, a way to model this kind of situation, should one think again to add a time dependence in the sound velocities?
This actually is a tricky point, because the most tricky point at present is to find the configuration where the horizon is free enough to feel the back reaction force, because normal configurations are such that the horizon is bound to some external thing. So in Jeff Steinauer experiment, the horizon is bound to the external potential. So you don't have really the way of seeing the horizon shrinking. So one of the big questions is to find a configuration where this doesn't happen. So what we are presently doing together with Giulio Butera, who is my former postdoc, who is now has a position in Glasgow, is to study more complicated configurations like spinor condensates, where one uses the density modes of the spinor condensate as a sort of a background metric, and the spin degrees of freedom are a sort of quantum field. Of course, this dynamics has nothing to do with the relativistic Einstein equations, no way, but leaves the metric degrees of freedom free enough to show some evolution in response to the back reaction.
Yeah, no, but my question was actually more basic. So even before going to experiment, from a theoretical point of view, the description of the black hole evaporation would correspond to what in the model? To put some time dependence in the speed velocity or what?
It would be that suppose you have a configuration which without quantum emission would be stationary. So you would see that this configuration evolves in time under the effect of quantum fluctuations. So if you think of the mirrors here, if you have no dynamical Casimir emission, you have that the mirror performs harmonic oscillation mode. Once you add the dynamical Casimir emission of photons, this motion is damped. Mm-hmm. This perhaps is the simplest way of understanding.
Okay, thanks.
So you see, you have a mirror which is neutral. So in principle, it feels no coupling to electromagnetic field. So it should oscillate forever in the absence of damping. Here,
this problem is not related to what you were saying before about the entanglement issue of having a time-dependent sound velocity.
No. This has no relation with that. No. There's a completely different sort of toy model where you see the Hamiltonian is this. So A is the cavity field, B is the mechanical oscillator. So you see for the two first part, the first two terms in the Hamiltonian, you have harmonic motion. Mm-hmm. If you add the third term, you have a dynamical Casimir generation of pairs of photons under the effect of a mechanical motion. And this, in turn, gives rise to a mechanical damping on the mechanical degrees of freedom.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, I have a question, Jacopo.
Yes, please.
Okay. This is related to the emitter moving in the condensate. Can you also realize similar experiments, but just in circuit QED, in which the emitter is fixed, but then you modulate the resonator in space-time or something similar?
You mean the emitter physics?
Yeah.
This, I think, Sal, is an extremely good question. I think something could be feasible in principle. So basically, you change the geometry of your superconducting network in a way that your emitter, which is physically at rest, sees an electromagnetic environment which moves in time.
Yes.
I think this is definitely feasible. Very good suggestion. Thanks.
Can I have a question?
Yes, sir.
Suppose that for some reason the underlying metric starts to emit gravitational waves. How large the feedback effects from gravitational waves or the oscillations of the metric itself do you expect to be?
Okay, so let me try to understand what you said. So you have a black hole, but the black hole does not live in empty space. It is subject to some gravitational waves. Yeah. And then you want to look how the Hawking emission is modified by these gravitational waves. This is your question.
For example, yes.
So, in a sense, you could ask Jeff Steinauer to add in his setup an emitter of sound waves and to let these sound waves hit the horizon while he measures the Hawking radiation. I have no idea.
So, expect it to show up in the Hawking radiation?
I think they should, yes. Because Hawking radiation is a crucial ingredient that the system is stationary. If you have a further time dependence, I think something different can arise. I would expect that things would be very different.
All right, thank you.
It's something that is worth being investigated. The formalism could be a bit cumbersome, but I don't think it would be completely unfeasible, because you are somehow mixing the spatial structure of a black hole with the temporal structure of a sort of dynamical Casimir effect where you are modulating the space-time in time. Okay, it's complicated, but it should not be a problem for brave people.
Yeah, right. Yeah, all right, thank you.
More questions? Well, if not, thank you, Jacopo, for the nice seminar.
Thank to all of you for the for being there, for the nice questions. Very stimulating.
Perfect. Then see you.
See you.
You all. Thank you all for being there.
Bye bye, everybody.
Ciao.
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 Ciao, fate bravi.
Ciao.